Hey, it's your girl Tracy, and I'm here to share some highlights with you about an event we did on August the 17th. We celebrated our 90th anniversary. I want to share the evening with you. Take it away, Mayor Fry.
Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder is an important element of Black history. I'm here because this is a legacy in Minneapolis. This is an institution in the state of Minnesota. This is Minneapolis history in every way, shape, and form. And when you have such an incredible leader like Tracey Williams Dillard, that's right, it's something that needs to be recognized, and something that was so evident to me when I walk through these doors is that everybody feels like family. Sometimes people are quite literally family in many instances. But beyond that, the spokesman recorder has created an aura where you feel at home. You know, when you walk down 38th Street, you feel at home. When you go visit back in the day, you feel at home. When you read the spokesman recorder, wherever you are and whoever you're with, you feel community because it's literally embedded in the pages itself. And so in honor of this momentous occasion, in honor of 90 years worth of incredible service, in honor of the longest running Black business, the longest running newspaper, I believe in the entire country, this is something that we truly need to celebrate in the form, yes, of a proclamation. And so, you want it? Yeah, there you go. It's heavy. So since 1934, the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder newspaper has served as a cornerstone of news and information with a dedicated service to the African American community of Minnesota. And whereas the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is Minnesota's oldest Black-owned newspaper business and one of the nation's longest standing family-owned newspapers. That's right. And whereas the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is the product of a merger of the Minneapolis Spokesman and St. Paul Recorder, proving that we can indeed get along. Both publications have been founded by the legendary Cecil E. Newman in 1934. And whereas throughout his life, Cecil E. Newman was a persistent civil rights activist who advanced employment opportunities and bettered educational and housing access for Black Minnesotans. And whereas, now under the leadership of Newman's granddaughter, Tracey Williams Dillard, the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder has continued to champion community perspectives and stories that might otherwise go unheard. And whereas, for nine decades, the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder has provided invaluable coverage for African American residents in Minneapolis and across the state, including service in the midst of the Great Depression, news of Black soldiers in global wars, and reporting on the murder of George Floyd and civil unrest. And whereas the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder continues to advance work in eradicating disparities across education, healthcare, and business, including the cultivation of a Black small business development campaign and a reliable avenue for news and stories throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. And whereas, you get a long proclamation when you've been around for 90 years, the city of Minneapolis is delighted to extend a congratulations to the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder for 90 years of service and commitment to the city and its residents, whereas the city of Minneapolis is so deeply grateful for the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder's unwavering commitment to the betterment of community and recognizes the publication's unique contributions and uplifting voices and perspectives of African American residents in Minneapolis and well beyond. Now, therefore, I, Jacob Fry, mayor of the city of Minneapolis, do hereby proclaim August 17th, 2024, as Spokesman Recorder Day in the city of Minneapolis. Thank you so much, everybody. Here's to another 90 years. Thank you so much.
Greetings, I'm St. Paul Mayor Melvin Carter. On behalf of the City of St. Paul, I want to extend my congratulations to the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder on reaching an incredible milestone of 90 years of community journalism and service to your readers. While I cannot attend the Anniversary Gala, I join you and countless community leaders and organizations in celebrating the work of the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder to uplift the spirit and experiences of our African American community. The Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is not only our state's oldest Black-owned newspaper, but it also continues to serve as a trusted voice for our diverse communities here in Minnesota. We owe the Spokesman Recorder a great deal of gratitude for your power in storytelling and advocating for a more just future for all of us. As we honor the memory of pioneers like Cecil Newman, who, in addition to being founder of this historic publication, was also a pillar of our community here in Minnesota, I want to honor all of you who have answered the journalistic call to continue this work and pursue stories that need to be told and heard. Congratulations, and may there be many more decades ahead for the Spokesman Recorder. Happy 90th anniversary.
Well, I'm not sure who that young Mr. Carter is, but he certainly seem to know me. My apologies. I failed to properly introduce myself. I'm Cecil E. Newman, publisher and editor of the St. Paul Recorder and Minneapolis Spokesman newspaper, which, as of today, you can get delivered by carrier to your home for only 5 cents a week. Or you can subscribe for a full year for only $2. Yes. And to quote myself, both papers will speak out fearlessly and unceasingly against injustice, discriminations, and all imposed inequalities, no matter what group or nationality they are visited upon. That is my promise. Our promise, to give the people of each of these communities a paper they can trust and of which they can be proud. And we will do so for as long as we possibly can. Who knows? With the right amount of support, we might even be around come the turn of the century. Allow a man to have a dream. Well, enough of idle chat. I have papers to run and people to see, and I really should be getting ahead of myself. 90 years ahead of myself, to be exact. So please, welcome back your host for the scintillating soiree, Angela Davis.
Thank you, Cecil. I'm sure we'll do our best to make you proud. I know that you are here tonight, like me, to commemorate and celebrate this important milestone in the remarkable story of our legendary community newspaper, which has been an invaluable community resource now for 90 years. Our theme tonight is Inspire, Inform, Impact. Three characteristics that embody the work of the Minnesota the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. This evening, we will hear from African-American leaders and community members about how Cecil E. Newman has inspired them and his vision and his groundbreaking leadership and how his trusted newspaper, which continued under the stewardship of his wife, Leuna, and now his granddaughter, Tracey Williams-Dillard, has informed and impacted its loyal readers over the past 9 tumultuous decades. We'll have a conversation with Tracey right here on the stage tonight and some other people too about what the future holds. And Ms. Shannon is here tonight. I don't know if you've seen us. She'll be joining us later tonight to help us support Minnesota Spokesman Recorder as they move into their next 90 years. So I want you to Listen to me for a moment, because I really want to take time to say thank you to our sponsors, because you know, without our sponsors, we can't have grand events like this. So first, I would like to say thank you to our founding partner tonight, our founding partner sponsor, Blue Cross Blue Shield. Thank you very much. Our community sponsors, U.S. Bank, Build Wealth, and UCare. Thank you very much. And we have many other wonderful event sponsors. You can see their names up on the screens here in the room. Please join me in thanking them all for their generosity with another round of applause. Thank you to our sponsors. All right, we have a very special treat for you. For your listening pleasure during dinner while we'll eat, we'll be entertained by a very gifted and innovative musician and artist, a remarkable jazz and R&B harpist. You see the big harp here? Maria Antoinette is here. Maria is a sought-after jazz artist, appearing at many jazz festivals around the world, major fundraisers, and has also performed at the Hollywood Bowl, the BET Awards, and for Michelle Obama and President Barack Obama. We're so happy to have Maria here with us tonight, sharing her captivating musical talent. A reminder, the silent auction is going to be closing soon, and this evening as well, we're going to have many these great video messages. You're going to have an opportunity to hear from so many people tonight on these video screens that we'll be sharing from friends of the Spokesman Recorder from over the decades. As we begin our meal, enjoy a few of these video reflections. Enjoy your food, and I'll talk to you again in just a few minutes.
There was no person in Hubert Humphrey's life who was more important in Hubert Humphrey's moral development on the subject of civil rights than Cecil Newman was. There would not be the Hubert Humphrey we knew, and there would not have been, I think, the success Hubert Humphrey had in winning the battle within the Democratic Party on behalf of civil rights in the 1940s without the way Humphrey had been affected and influenced and inspired by Cecil Newman. One of the great joys of the work I did over 8.5 years on the book was to read every single published word of Cecil Newman's from 1922 until 1948. Imagine being the young editor of a black newspaper in a city like Minneapolis with the tremendous problems it had with racism, and you're writing editorials looking favorably on the Communist Party. Cecil Newman was reporting on police brutality in this city. You can trace the road to George Floyd's murder from what Cecil Newman was writing in the 1930s. Cecil Newman would call out labor unions that wouldn't have black members, even while those unions portrayed themselves as being so liberal. Cecil Newman, when he found out major breweries in the Twin Cities wouldn't hire black workers, Cecil Newman organized a boycott of those breweries by black consumers. So Cecil Newman would stand up to anybody on any issue at any time on behalf of equal rights.
Seems like the Spokesman Recorder has been in my life most of my life because of my Uncle Gordon Parks. Uncle Gordon, his first professional career, and I would say his love connection, was with the Spokesman Recorder, because Mr. Newman hired him as a young journalist and photographer. He shared with me, as I was his, you know, grandniece and his protege, you know, his appreciation for the family and for the paper, because Mr. Newman believed in him. That relationship was there, and the Spokesman Recorder stayed in Uncle Gordon's spirit and soul all of his life. Uncle Gordon knew what I was doing even when he went on to his great profession. He took the paper until he died. So when Uncle Gordon, when I did something and it was in the paper, he called me and said, "Oh, baby, I read in the paper, you know, congratulations." He heard it first in the Spokesman Recorder. But for me, my fondest connection was my dear sister, is my dear sister Tracy, as two black women and media makers. We've had a special bond. She was my vision of possibilities as a businesswoman, as a communicator, dedicated to lifting up the positive narratives of our people, our community, So we're joined at the hip. We're two black women who have always shown love for one another, especially in a profession where it was just so important to support one another's light, to model that to other black women, to young black women. I always knew that I could bring the young people that I mentored to Tracy to say, hey, you know, I need you to mentor them. I need you to be a vision of possibilities for the young people that were in my life that I tried to pour into.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. How's everybody doing? You look beautiful out there. As she stated, my name is Maria Antoinette, and that is my real name. That is the name of my birth certificate. I don't know why my father decided to do that to me. But anyway, the first two songs you heard was from my album, Straight from the Harp, both original tunes. The first one is titled The Overture, and then the second one, Fly Away. We're going to, I'm going to play a variety of selections from my last three albums, and some that you will recognize and know, because I love R&B, so I'll be doing some covers, those that you will recognize, and some new stuff as well. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the music. Thank you. Thank you. That was an original song titled Africa. Can't resist Minnie Riperton loving you. It's a classic. Next up, we have something for the ladies in the house, because you know we got that thing. We have something special about us. So this song is dedicated to you ladies.
Thank you.
little bit of Lauryn Hill there. This is up another original tune titled Sekhmet. And those of you who delve into a little bit of ancient Egyptian history, Sekhmet was a warrior goddess. And so I did a song in honor of her, and this is titled Sekhmet. Thank you. Beckmet.
Thank you.
journey. Could we get a nice hand for our amazing harpist, Maria Antoinette? We'd like everyone to please take your seats as our program will resume in just a few minutes. Everyone, please make your way back to your tables. Our program will resume in just a few minutes.
please turn your attention to the screens.
Congratulations, Minneapolis, St. Paul Spokesman Recorder, Minnesota Spokesman Recorder, for your many years of contributing factual news about our struggle here in the Twin Cities, Minnesota, and throughout the country.
Thank you for putting the message out and being the spokesperson and the standard bearer for our communities for so many years.
Back in the day, the local Pioneer Press and Minneapolis Star and Tribune, they would always tell part of our stories or give their slant of the story. But the good thing and the best thing about the Spokesman Recorder was that many of the writers that worked for you, the reporters, were also members of our community. They were active and contributing members to our community, and they had their hands on the pulse. In my old age, I'm optimistic that the legacy of the Spokesman Reporter through Tracey Williams and other family members will continue to offer that valuable resource for my children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. So I thank Almighty God for y'all's contribution and for your sacrifice.
Love you guys.
Importance of the Spokesman Recorder to me and my family started back in the early 50s, and we were just, that was our newspaper. That was the way we got news from both the Twin Cities, Minneapolis and St. Paul, what's going on. It's just been a blessing to have a newspaper that actually reflects the things that are going on in the African American community. I was the youngest member elected to the National Board of the NAACP at the age of 17 with Thurgood Marshall, Margaret Bush Wilson, and Roy Wilkins. And to sit at the board table with those people and listen to the conversations that were going on, and then taking that information and bringing it back to the Twin Cities and sharing it with those people that are impacting or making decisions that are impacting the African-American community. But when we talk about the Spokesman Recorder, those are the things that they share and get out to the people that read it and understand, hey, this is things we can do, or how do we support each other? So those are the blessings that I think that I've learned and shared with the Spokesman Recorder. And it's just been a great resource for the African-American community, both in St. Paul and Minneapolis. So thank you for this opportunity to share my thoughts with you.
Congratulations to the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder, which has been in my life, well, all my life. Congratulations and happy birthday on 90 years. And I recall when I was growing up in St. Paul, that's how we got our news. That's how we learned about our neighbors. That's how we continued to support one another. And that's how we were able to come together through the news that we received via the recorder. And then we knew what steps to take in order to help move our people forward. So to this day, it still remains to me, I have to have my recorder. I have to have my Spokesman Recorder weekly so that I can, see what's going on, not only in Minnesota, but beyond, so that we can continue to upraise our people. And so I want to thank the recorder, the Spokesman Recorder, for all you've done for us and continue to do. And we will keep it alive for 90 more years.
And now, please welcome back to the stage your host, Angela Davis.
Hey, hello again. Did you enjoy your meal? Yeah, the chicken, the mashed potatoes, it was good. All right. So we've had some great conversation, and now we're going to move forward with another part of the program. We're going to do some interviews. We're going to go on the record for some interviews right now, and I hope that you will enjoy it. I want to welcome to the stage with me for a segment that we're calling On the Record. You recognize the lady in the beautiful red dress. Have we not been checking out the gown tonight? Please welcome the CEO and publisher of the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder, TRACEY WILLIAMS-DILLARD. And just again, I love your gown. You look spectacular. And I love seeing the smile on your face tonight.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you. So TRACEY, 90 years, my God, 90 years. The Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder has such a rich history. And so I know you've been reflecting for several months, planning for tonight, but what are some of the things that really stand out to you as you look back of 90 years in the history of this newspaper?
Wow, you know, Angela, it's one of the things, first of all, it's just amazing. When I think about it, I'm totally overwhelmed with the thought of the impact that this paper's had on my life as a little girl. When my grandmother first brought me into the paper, I remember I was 8 years old, and there's this picture I want to show you of my grandmother with my grandfather.
Oh, and, family photo.
And I wonder if you can recognize who I am in that picture.
Okay, which pigtails are yours? You're the one in the middle, the three little kids at the bottom, you're in the middle?
I'm the one doing this with my fingers.
Doing this?
Yeah. And that's about the age my grandmother brought me into the paper so that I could, she wanted to just figure out how she could get me engaged. So this was a start. And so I remember her being at her desk working every day and me going in as a young girl. And then, you know, I want you to see that picture of her at her desk. Now, isn't she just looking cute?
She looks naughty. She's like, I'm about to tell some things.
She does. She does. And I remember them moments so well. But you know, she brought me in, and she brought me in at a really early age, and she wanted to teach me the ropes of the paper. So one of the things that she taught me was how to run this machine, and it's called an addressograph machine. And it's
a what a graph?
Uh-huh. Addressograph. So it puts your labels on the paper, and then from there it gets mailed out through the postal service.
Okay.
And I ran that machine. I learned how to run it, and I ran it. And I was ripping them papers through there, putting the labels on it and getting them out, and I felt proud. I felt like I was helping to get the paper out. I was really doing something. And that's such a memorable moment for me. Then things, I lost, my grandmother, she started to, you know, need to look at the time to pass the paper on. So she started looking at her son and her daughter, my mother, my uncle, and she knew they were near retiring. And so she really knew this paper needed the energy to keep it really going and moving it into the 21st century. So she kept looking at me, and she was trying to decide. She went to my sister at one point, and she goes, I'm thinking about giving the paper to TRACEY. What do you think? My sister's like, she's been with this paper since she was 8. She's been here for a long time. She's committed to it. I think it's a good move, and so it
are
just
you still wringing your hands sometimes?
I do, and more so sometimes than others. And so you know, so it just kind of brought me in. So that you know, so then when along the way of all that memory, the other thing that I really remember is my mother, who I lost last year. She was always there to support me. She was that person that was always by my side, and I want to show this picture of her when my mother was there.
She's so pretty. Yeah.
And she was there at this time. That was when the Small Business Revolution came, and they filmed the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder for almost a year. And they came and they painted my building. They gave me new furniture. They gave me new computers and everything. So my mom and my daughter there in that picture, they were just always my champion. But the main thing was, just that they were always there to support me, and they still are.
So your most memorable moments really go back to your earliest years in life.
They do. Very much so.
Cecil's wife, Leuna, was an important figure in the history of the Spokesman-Recorder, and she became the CEO after Cecil Newman's death in 1976. So what do you remember about the newspaper under her guidance?
Well, I know One of the things that really stuck out to me was when my grandfather passed. At that time, it was like not a lot of women running newspapers. Mm-hmm. And I remember it was like vultures, I felt, coming in trying to figure out how they could get the paper from my grandmother. Now they were like no confidence in her being able to continue to run it. And
because she was a woman?
Because she was a woman. And she just was like, my husband started this, he started for a reason, and I'm gonna keep it going, whatever it takes. And
she did it.
And she did. She kept it going, and I remember there was a judge who they were trying to get her off the bench, and my grandmother fought to keep her on the bench. There were a lot of fights that my grandmother still was out there fighting for equality for women and for black people themselves. So she took and carried that legacy of my grandfather, and she was a very powerful woman. And
so this is the late 70s, early 80s we're talking about.
Correct, because he passed in 76, so that's when she took it on.
So when we look at today, the state of journalism today, the state of local news, when you're thinking about the spokesman recorder today and its role in journalism, its role that it's playing in keeping the black community informed, why is it so important that this legacy continues, that it not only survives, but that it thrives?
Well, it's important because we tell a story. We tell stories that no other media tells. In Minnesota, no matter how...
Clap, please. Right?
No matter how far you look, no matter how hard you dig, you won't find this history that we have recorded for the last 90 years. You won't find it anywhere. And you won't find... And you won't find this story in the next 90 years that we're going to be around, because we are the community. We're a part of the community. We're the thread of the community. And right now, with news being so diluted with all the different podcasts and all the different things that are out there that people can, that they're flooding the airwaves with, people look for something they can believe and trust, and something that they know is going to tell their story. The Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder is that voice.
Tracey, I think this would be a perfect time to bring up another guest to talk with, your daughter, Leticia. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Leticia Alvarez. If you will come up and join us, we're going to talk to you for a little bit.
Hey.
I believe you're among friends here tonight.
Yeah, some folks here. Yeah.
So what does it feel like? Well, tonight for this celebration, 90 years being commemorated and celebrated, but also for you to be next in line for this legacy.
Listen, Angela, I want to first tell you thank you for being here. And I want to thank the audience, because we are not without each of you. I must say, it's overwhelming thinking about taking over something so powerful. But I have to. It's my duty to.
And you feel supported,
hopefully. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Listen, I got a room full of folks that's gonna support me, right? That part. But as we were preparing for our 90th celebration, I was doing our research. And I was reading about marches on Washington, and I was reading about the fight in Selma. And I was reading also about here, right here, with Philando Castile, Dante Wright, George Floyd. And I have to make sure that those stories are told. And so, I think about my ancestors. I think about the shoulders of which I stand on. I think about Cecil E. Newman. I think about Leuna Q. Newman. I think about Norma Williams. I think about Jack Jackman. And I think about Tracey Williams-Dillard. And I am honored and I am empowered to take the MSR, the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder newspaper, into the next 90 years.
All right.
And you're supporting. Cecile, you're an educator. Do you see this correlation between education and journalism and the role that the spokesman recorder can play?
Wow, absolutely. Right. I mean, the paper is education. We're educating the community as the community is educating the world. And so I think about the students that I inspire, and I think about the students in which I work and serve, and I have to make sure that their voices are heard. I think about here in the state of Minnesota where our black and brown babies are not graduating at the rates that they should be. I think about the disproportionalities of our black and brown humans that are trying to survive here in the state of Minnesota. And who else and what other platform other than the MSR is there to deliver that? And so I want to make sure that I use that platform to make sure that my students' voices, my students' stories, the stories of educators, the stories of our people, the stories of this room are upheld and loudly announced. And so, yeah.
All right. Leticia, I wish you well and look forward to holding hands with you in this journey as we move forward, right?
Let's go.
Okay, I have in my notes something about another guest, there's another chair here, that the two of you wanted to bring up someone else to speak to our audience. Something here about a rock and roll Hall of Fame composer, writer, producer, some guy named Jimmy Jam Harris is here. Jimmy Jam, is that you? Oh my God, the guy in the fedora? That was Jimmy Jam? Nice to see you again.
All right.
So, actually, Jimmy, I know that you actually have a very okay. Now you're ready. Okay, let's get ready. You actually have a beautiful story, a very personal connection to the spokesman recorder that I had never heard through many interviews. Stories I've heard about you through your mother. And through Tracey, tell us about the connection to the spokesman recorder that your family has and about one of your favorite memories about the newspaper.
My favorite memory of the spokesman was actually, I went to Bryant Junior High School over on the south side. I know we got some Bryant people in the house. I've been seeing them. I love that. And that's where I met Prince, by the way. We were both students at Bryant Junior High back in the day. But right around the corner, literally from Bryant Junior High, was the spokesman. And I used to get a chance to go there when my mother worked there. And she'd, after school, I would always walk over there. And it was an amazing experience. And it feels so full circle to be here tonight because I feel like, in a way, it honors my mother's legacy. But it also, you mentioned storytelling. And that, to me, is what it's all about. It's telling our own stories. And I was looking at an old spokesman article about a birthday party that I had, probably at 7 years old or something like that. And the reason that people know about that is because it was in the spokesman. So I'm so happy to be a part of that legacy and a part of that history. Mm-hmm. And thank you for telling that. Mm-hmm. Thank you for telling that.
And Jimmy, I know that you're someone that is often sought after for interviews. You may find in your email a request from me for an interview. But as someone who is very high profile and people always want to interview you and get your opinion about things, about the music industry, why do you feel the black press is so, so important in general, but also to the music industry?
Well, once again, as has been said, but you can't really say it enough, it's important to be able to tell our own stories. There's so much nuance to our story, and sometimes it's easy to kind of take a look and just, but I see there's so much diversity in this room. Like, you can say this is a room of black people, but there's so much diversity in each one of those stories, and you need to have the correct lens in order to see it. And our lens on seeing ourselves is the correct lens to have. And that's why it's so important that we have that. We work on a show, Terry and I are doing the music for a show on Hulu called Unprisoned. And it's a comedy, it's kind of a dramedy, it's kind of the combination. Please stream it, by the way. We appreciate that on Hulu. You can binge watch it, it's really good. Anyway, but one of the things that was interesting was because you're having characters, and by the way, the story is based in Minnesota. for those of you guys that didn't know that, which is the reason we signed on to do it. But what was interesting was, from the kind of, I'll say the Disney point of view, there was a very specific thing that I think they were happening, and as we started delivering music, it was kind of like that sometimes we would get the note that, well, I'm not sure whether that's something that black people would play. And we're like going, huh? What are you talking about? And I don't think it was ill-intentioned, by the way. I don't think that somebody had the intention of saying that, but it made me realize that if there weren't the right people in the room, then the wrong decisions are going to be made. Mm-hmm. So I was happy to be in that room. And when you listen to the music for Unprisoned, you hear everything. You hear everything from Saturday Love to, you know, all of those records we grew up with, but you also hear orchestral themes. You hear all the different complexities of the characters through the music. And I think because we are so complex, we need to be the ones that tell those stories. Mm-hmm. Simple as that.
Yeah.
And let's just, in our remaining time, did you want to ask Jimmy a question before he?
I would. And so I think about, you say storytelling, and I think about the theme of tonight is legacy. And there are some young people in the room, and I want to make sure that they're hearing from us. What is something that you would leave with the young people here in the room that will allow them to carry on the legacies of those that are here on the stage?
So I can say this from the perspective of an older person now. Now that I qualified for my AARP card and all that stuff, I get my 10% discount.
Watch it, Jimmy. You're the same grade now.
But the thing that I'll tell you, the general thing I always say when I speak to people, whether young people, old people, just the people in the room in general, I always say be prepared. Now, be prepared sounds like kind of a cliche almost, I think, for a lot of people in some ways. But what I mean by being prepared is, a lot of times when people seek us out for, you know, give me a break, I'm looking for my break, I'm waiting for my chance, I'm waiting for whatever. And I always say the word waiting should not be in your vocabulary. You should switch the word waiting with the word preparing. Oh. I'm not waiting for my break, I'm preparing for my break.
Right.
I'm reading everything I can read, I'm getting to know the people involved and whatever, so that when that chance does happen and you come upon me, you can then articulate what it is that you want to do. You can be prepared. Sometimes I'll say to a room, if it's like a bunch of music people, I'll say, how many singers do we have in the room? And so there'll be some hands that'll go up. And I'll say, come up here and sing. And they'll go, oh, well, I'm not ready, I'm not whatever. It's like, no, be prepared. That's what I mean by being prepared.
Stay ready so you don't have to get ready.
Stay ready, that's right. Come ready, you don't have to get ready. James Brown, I believe. Well, I attribute it to James Brown. I'm sure a lot of people have said that, but that's the James Brown. Anyway, to me, that's the really important thing. The other thing, too, in a gathering like this, which is such, I would call it an elevated gathering tonight, I don't think anybody's chairs or tables are actually touching the floor. You realize that. We're actually more like this, right, in the elegance of this room. So get to know the people that are around you. A lot of times when I do that same thing and I'll say, how many writers in the room, how many producers in the room, how many video people in the room, attorneys in the room, lawyers in the room, agents in the room, whatever. And by the time, everybody's hand is raised. And I so look around the room, because anything that you want to build, it's all here in the room, right? Amen. So the partners that you seek in continuing this legacy into the future, everybody is right here in the room. Don't look for other people. We're all right here in this room.
Right.
Okay. Right?
All right.
We can get it done.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Jimmy, welcome home. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Leticia. Thank you, Tracy, for your time. We're going to move forward with the program. And I want you to give your attention to the video monitors, because we have some more messages from special friends to the Spokesman Recorder.
Thank you. Thank you, Angela.
Hi, my name is Craig Rice. I was born in the Twin Cities and raised in St. Paul and Minneapolis, and so I've been a native of the Twin Cities. I have found that the Spokesman Recorder, especially when I was growing up, how important it was as a media for, specifically for African Americans, but really sort of displaying the truth and displaying our achievements over the years. I was lucky enough to be the neighbor, literally a house away from growing up with Cecil Newman, and I, at a time when I didn't even actually know what a newspaper was, he was always out there and invited me and my sisters and brothers into the house regularly. He had an incredible ability to keep you, even as a child, I mean a little child, five-year-old, six-year-old child, engaged in his desire to educate you and inform you about the things that are important for African Americans, specifically to get you to be proud of who you are and what you are in this country that's obviously primarily dominated by white Americans. He encouraged me to be a communicator and to communicate, not knowing that I would ever make films or make music or write or anything like that, but really to put myself out there. When I first decided to go to college, the Spokesman Recorder gave me a small scholarship to start college, which I, to this day, I'm here because of that first scholarship payment. So I've always been sort of had this place for this newspaper in my life and my heart, and I'm really pleased and hope people really understand the importance of the Spokesman Recorder. I know sometimes people think it's just a pamphlet, but no, it is heart and soul of Black America, Black Minnesota, wherever.
When I was young, maybe 10th grade, and I was at Minneapolis Central, and I was in newspaper class. We weren't doing much, and anyway, I end up coming up to the Minneapolis Spokesman to try to find a story. Tracy Williams' grandfather, who ran the Minneapolis Spokesman, brought me in, and he brought me into his office, and he asked me what I wanted. Well, I had told him at the time I had got kicked out of class, and they told me, go somewhere and go find a story. And so he brought me in his office, and he sat me down, and he said, what's your name? I told him my name, Philip Crawford. And he said, okay, Mr. Crawford. And throughout the interview, because I asked him how it started and he explained this stuff. Throughout the interview, he called me Mr., and which I thought was, I mean, just so uplifting because I had never been called Mr. before. And you know, that really instilled in me some pride.
Hi, my name is Wendy Puckett, and I just want to give thanks to Sister Spokesman and the Spokesman Recorder on being a great part of my life. We can build people and uplift the businesses around us and let the community know that we're here. It's important for spokesmen and sister spokesmen to stay around because it connects people. It keeps us together as one. It shows the community that women of color and all women can get together and do amazing things. Thank you and blessings to you.
Grandpa used to always, whenever I would go see him, be willing to extend me money. And so he would give me coins, and that was a message to me that he believed in giving back to individuals so that they could grow and have opportunity. He really carried that message and cultivated that across my entire family. When I became an older young woman, I had the opportunity to go to college. That opportunity would not have been afforded to me had it not been for my grandfather and the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. Certainly, there were people in between the process that contributed that to that, which was my parents, my grandmother, Leanna Newman, and my aunt. I essentially was the first scholarship awardee from Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. And since that period, there's been annual identification of students who should get scholarships. From the very beginning, my grandfather's intention was to tell the stories of Black people in a positive way and not just negative. And when they were negative, making sure that the facts were embedded in the stories to make sure that we are right, sending the right messages and depicting situations correctly. I will end with, I am so super thrilled to be at this point in life in looking at the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder that has been around for 90 years. And it took a whole community to get it to its place. I am appreciative of the community's contribution and the fact that the family, along with the community, has been able to keep it vibrant and alive.
Thank you. Thank you. We have another guest who flew in from out of town to be with us tonight. He flew in from Washington, D.C. I want to introduce you to Dr. Benjamin Franklin Chavis. Dr. Chavis is a renowned civil rights leader, ordained minister, author, journalist. He served as a national president of the NAACP. He currently serves as president and CEO of the National Newspaper Publishers Association, and that's a trade association that represents about 200 black-owned newspapers around the country. He's a prominent figure in the civil rights movement. Dr. Chavis has been an aide to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and gained national attention as the leader of the Wilmington 10. He's been instrumental in shaping the environmental justice movement, coining the term environmental racism in 1982, and he led the historic Million Man March, I think back in 1995. I had the honor of being there as a young reporter for KSCP-TV. He co-founded the Hip Hop Summit Action Network, and today he continues to advocate for justice and equity as a leader in various organizations, and is also the executive producer and host of the Chavis Chronicles on PBS. He's with us tonight. Good evening. Welcome to Minnesota.
Thank you, Angela.
Chavis, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
So you've done so much. You're talking to people around the country all the time. Tell us, how do you describe the significance, the importance of the black press today in 2024?
Thank you, Angela. The black press in 2024 is actually 197 years old. Since 1827, Freedom's Journal in New York was first published. I just want to take time to let you know that we have publishers here from New York, from Los Angeles, from Florida, from Baltimore. I just want my publishers to stand up.
In the room tonight?
Yes.
Oh, welcome to Minnesota. Yeah. Hey.
And we've all.
Oh, thank you for being here.
I've come from Washington, D.C. Oh, and Denver is also in the house.
Hey.
And Claudette Perry and I work for the NNPA. I've come to salute one of the most gifted and talented publishers in this world, and that's Tracey Williams-Dillard. And I'm going to answer your question, but also I'm an OG. So I got to recognize Jimmy Jams. Thank you, brother. One OG to another. Some of y'all know what OG stands for.
The Black Press.
The Black Press is the trusted voice of Black America. The Black Press is the trusted voice of people of African descent throughout the diaspora. And we are very fortunate to have the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder and the other, actually it's 250 African-American-owned newspapers across the country. And of course now, you know, we live in a digital age, so there's a struggle to keep our print papers together as well as do the digital and social media. I'm so proud of our publishers. And let me just say that 50% of our publishers are black women.
Oh.
Salute to black women.
Yeah, 56%.
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes, and so, and then I saw Letitia, Tracy's daughter. I know the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is gonna be in good hands for another 90 years. And then the last point I wanna say about the black press, sometimes we have been viewed over the last 100 years or more as a marginal press. But you know, the demographics of the United States has changed. Mm-hmm. We're much more diverse. We're a much more multicultural community. And I would say that the black press in 2024 is emerging as the new mainstream press. So the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is just not for black people. It's for all people.
Right.
And the black press is for all people. I teach a course at Duke University, and I tell my students, there's only one race, and that's the human race.
Correct.
And so we have to, but the problem is, because of racism, because of discrimination, we look for what divides us as a humanity rather than what brings us together as a humanity. And so I think that I'm optimistic. I think the black press has a great future, not only for 90 more years, but for centuries to come. But we must also not take for granted where we are. We got to get this vote out in 2024. And the only way we're going to get this vote out, the black press has to lead the way, because there's all kind of misinformation and disinformation out there trying to make our people think that our vote is not welcome or granted, and we should never take our vote for granted, because for black people and for the black press, voting is sacred. We bled, we died, we went to prison, lost our lives to get the right to vote. So I hope nobody in here, in fact, Minnesota, you got a chance to have a vice president of the United States. And you got a chance to have the first black woman as the president of the United States of America. Now, I know I gave you a long answer to a question.
But that's okay.
I'll try to give you a shorter answer.
Well, as we think about this moment that we're living in now with a very contentious presidential, the campaigns, the upcoming election, and we think about the significance of a trusted voice. Yeah. So what is the role that the black press can play at such a pivotal time in history?
Thank you. Very good. I'm going to give you a short answer.
Well, you see the clock. You see the
yes,
clock.
Yes, I see the clock.
It's an opportunity.
There's a hunger and thirst for accurate facts. Yeah. We live in an age of fake news. We live in an age of disinformation. We live in an age of misinformation. We live in an age where the majority of stuff that's out there on social media is not accurate. And so that is why the black press becomes so strategic, mm-hmm. so vital to all of America. We say that the black press is the soul of America. W. Du Bois wrote a book about the soul of black people. But I would venture to say that in 2024, particularly during this election, that if we're going to have a massive voter turnout in all communities, the black press has to lead that charge.
Mm-hmm. I can visualize it. Can't you see it, right? Like massive voter turnout.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Because down in Georgia, if I want to talk about Minnesota, they make it illegal while you're in the line to vote for anybody to give you a bottle of water.
This is true.
So, you know, I've been arrested 6 or 7 times. Because
how many times?
6 or 7.
Okay.
I'm going to get arrested again in Georgia because we're going to get a truckload of water. And then I'm just going to cut the ignition off. I'm not going to pass it out. People are going to come and get the water. Because we cannot allow this voter intimidation, we cannot allow this voter suppression to hold us down. Nowhere in America. I promise you I was going to be short.
One last question. Tonight, a celebration, but it's also the focus of the night, the goal of tonight is to make sure the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder not just survives but thrives. The financial component of that, it takes money to do this
very,
work.
Very
so what
important.
Can people in this room tonight do to make sure we're still talking about another 90 years of the Spokesman-Recorder?
Thank you. Everybody in the room should have a subscription to the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder. I mean a subscription. And then, you know, I'm a pastor. If you're in a church and your church don't have the black newspaper to pass out at Sunday school, at Bible study on Wednesday night, whenever we gather, we ought to have the black press. And then lastly, I know there's some corporate executives out here. And I believe in coalitions. The strength, you know, I work with Dr. King. Most people don't know we could not have made the advances in the 1960s without support, without coalitions. And I would command and commend the corporate leaders here from Minnesota. You should financially support the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder. Because when you support this black newspaper, You really support the future of Minnesota, the future of the United States of America. But that financial question, we need sustainability, and we need multiple income streams to keep our papers alive. And I just want to say one last point about finances. I think our young people across the board need more information that engages them. And I'm looking for my man, Jimmy Jams and others. I'm so glad that on Thursday night, Beyonce is going to hit the stage at the DNC.
She is?
Yes. I can make that announcement.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Some breaking news.
This is news. We're breaking news. The point I'm trying to make is, as my time has expired, the point I'm trying to make is we can make a real difference for the future of Minneapolis, St. Paul, the future of Minnesota, the future of the United States of America, for the future of the world. Let's come on, Black Press, let's get
All
it
right.
on.
Dr. Ben Chavis, the president and CEO of the National Newspaper Publishers Association, visiting us from Washington, D.C. Thank you, Dr. Chavis.
Thank you very much.
Time. Nice to meet you.
God bless.
All right. Thursday night, y'all heard it here. Okay. We have some more video messages that we would like you to take a look at as we get ready for our next speaker.
Cecil Newman used to work on the railroad, and the paper would travel with him and be sold in communities where the train stopped, and he would talk to Black passengers and learn about deaths, birth, marriages, and other social, cultural, and political events and include them in the paper. Cecil Newman's first publication was called Timely Digest, and he had a picture of Paul Robeson on the cover, which really says something about his courage and his willingness as a Black journalist to speak truth to power and to provide significant information to the African American community. The paper, down through the years under the guidance of his wife, Leona Newman, and now Tracey Williams, is a testimony to the resilience of our community and its legacy institutions, of which the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder is one of our greatest legacies. So it has been a privilege to be associated with it, to benefit from it, and to have it share news and information with our community.
So I always look at, particularly for Minneapolis and St. Paul, of us having the three institutions I call, which is KMOJ, Insight, and the Spokesman Recorder. When Black folks want true, accurate news about our community, that's where we should go. And so what's amazing, I always think, look at the historical context, the background and the will to start your own business 90 years ago, and what Black people had to endure back then, and then the battles of today, because our Black papers don't get anywhere near the advertisement that St. Paul Pioneer Press gets, Star Tribune, and our papers and our need that same support. I don't care if it's State Fair, the thing they had the other day on the river over here in terms of the yacht club thing, whatever they call it. They need to really put money and invest in these papers because it's our history. We can't lose institutions. And we lose too many Black institutions. To the Williams family, to the staff and the team at the Spokesman Recorder, happy 90th anniversary. I hope you have 90 more.
My mother took over the Spokesman. I felt that she needed help. I figured out how to bring in a different kind of machine, which was compographic. And I brought my wife in and taught her how to do this. And she became the graphic artist for me, the typesetter, and the mechanic on this machine. We ran that thing for about 15 years. Then we moved on and got the computer. We were the first Black newspaper in the country that had a computer. What did I do? I did a lot of good things. I've hired probably 10 people there myself. So I had two girls, Linda Mitchell and same practice. 120 words a minute typing. Put it out, making it happen. My wife would help my mother lay it out. We had a good crew. The black newspaper is very important because we do our news the way we want it, not the way they want it. That's like George Floyd when he died. Hey, here we are. You know, we're going to do it right. And we've hired a lot of people in this city. We used to have 20 people come in every Tuesday to fold paper. Then we had paper routes. And so it's really, a lot of people remember Spokesman, right? That we've done a lot of good things.
Thank you, Mr. Jackman. Good to see you here in the audience tonight as well. It's now my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker for the evening. I know, like we've had so many great speakers. There's more. He is the Senior Vice President of American Public Media Group and the President of Minnesota Public Radio, Deshaun Drew. And before he comes up, I want to tell you a little bit about him. In his role at NPR, Deshaun leads the teams that produce NPR News, The Current, APM Reports, and Marketplace. Before joining American Public Media Group, he led the Bush Foundation's leadership programs and community innovation and communication teams. Prior to that, Deshaun was the managing editor of operations for the Star Tribune newspaper. In 2019, he was honored with the Widening Circle Award by 360 Journalism that recognizes individuals who have contributed to the next generation of journalists, particularly while promoting diversity and inclusion. In 2021, he was inducted into the Hall of Achievement at Northwestern University's Medill School of Journalism. And in 2022, he was named to the Route 100, an annual list of the most influential Black Americans in the fields of arts, community, business, entertainment media, and politics. Please welcome to the stage right now a great guy who happens to be my husband, the president of NPR, Deshaun Drew.
Good evening. This is just an amazing night, an amazing moment. It feels like a big family reunion, and I'm just humbled to be here with you tonight, humbled to help lift up and celebrate the first 90, look forward to the next 90, look forward to rolling up my sleeves with you to make sure we get another 90. It matters that the Spokesman Recorder is here. It matters that we have this institution in our community. So I'm gonna do a little stroll down memory lane. I was a history major in college, and in spending time thinking about what I wanted to say tonight, I spent hours and hours looking at old copies of the paper. And so you're not gonna have to go through all of it with me. I'll get you home at a decent time, I promise you. But I really wanted to share some of the moments that mattered most and really kind of drive home the importance of this institution to our community. And I'm gonna start by setting the scene. As the pages go by, I'm not gonna try and go through all the things, so spend some time both listening and taking in how much they were accomplishing with each issue. I'm gonna pull out like one thing per page. But there's a lot there, a lot of rich information there. So in 1934, the world was roiling. We were just halfway through the Great Depression, so things were still getting worse, especially for Black folks. Farmers across the country, including in Minnesota, were sliding into bankruptcy at an alarming rate. And the Minneapolis Teamsters went on a three-month violent strike in a quest for union recognition, as well as better wages and working conditions. In Washington, D.C., FDR rolled out the New Deal to address the challenges of the day. In Harlem, the Apollo Theater opened on 125th Street, establishing one of America's preeminent entertainment venues. And in cities and towns across the country, people streamed into movie theaters to watch The Imitation of Life, an Academy Award-nominated film with a central character who was biracial and passed for white. Across the Atlantic, Adolf Hitler was ascending, laying the groundwork for World War II. It was a great, challenging time and an incredibly important moment in our community. In the Twin Cities, Cecil Newman knew there was a need and an opportunity to provide news and information to the black community, his community. On October 10th, he stepped up to fill the void and seize the moment by launching the Minneapolis Spokesman and the St. Paul Recorder. The weekly papers, written and edited by residents of those cities, changed what it meant to live here. I'm going to say that again. Starting these papers changed what it meant to live here. That continues to be the case. In his opening note to readers, which is featured in the top center column of the page up on the screen, Newman wrote, "We believe the majority of the people of both St. Paul and Minneapolis will give wholehearted support to any newspaper which actually and consistently serves the best interests of the respective communities." He went on to write, "It is our desire that each of the staff members of both publications to give people, each of these communities, a paper they can trust and of which they may be proud." They have so delivered on that promise over the 90 years. Through the decades, the Spokesman and the Recorder chronicled black life, spotlighting both national and regional issues. It's done so by centering black people. In a society where our stories have often been ignored or misrepresented in the mainstream media, having our own news outlets has been and continues to be essential. I oversee the second largest newsroom in the state, and while we and other mainstream newsrooms have made important progress over the last 90 years, the need for the Spokesman Recorder is as important today as it was 90 years ago. From capturing the joy of black soldiers at the end of World War II, to the hope that spread across the land in the wake of the 1954 Brown decision that struck down legal segregation, the Spokesman and the Recorder reflected our contributions, our sacrifices, our obstacles, and our perseverance. The staff took national stories and captured how local folks were experiencing them and thinking about them. When it came to big moments, such as the 1965 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, which attracted 250,000 people, the Spokesman and Recorder showed how local people, from Matt Little and Roy Wilkins to Hubert Humphrey, were having a huge national impact. When Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated a few years later, the Spokesman and Recorder chronicled the pain felt around the world. Dr. King's life and death were covered far and wide. Having our lens on the loss of one of our nation's greatest leaders was essential. And the paper's coverage of local leaders, black and white, traveling to Atlanta to pay their respects to Dr. King was a tremendous service to our community. Over the years, the papers consistently marked our milestones toward realizing the American dream. This issue from February of 1970 was the paper's 20th annual Negro Progress edition. Let that wash over you. The intentionality of taking an issue and dedicating to the progress we were making, despite the challenges, there were always people getting it done and building the steps that we all are walking on today. And there were so many black leaders to hold up over the years. This issue from October 1987 celebrated Dr. Aretha Clark King's 10th year leading Metropolitan State University. Yeah. And just goes on and on and on. There were just so many wonderful people, wonderful stories called out, raised up, alongside the hard things. And I think that's, in some respects, maybe the most important message I want to deliver tonight is that it wove together this thread of the reality of black life, the beauty of black life, the pain at times, but the people, the good people who call this place home, striving to make it better still. In this particular article, they noted that they were announcing at that time an endowed scholarship in Dr. Clark King's name for women, minorities, and other disadvantaged people. Once again, letting people know what opportunities were out there to support them in their journey. I bet some people in the room remember this cover. The 1993 election of Sharon Sales Belton as Minneapolis's first black and first female mayor was one of the biggest stories of that decade, and the Spokesman and Recorder covered it thoroughly, giving their readers a great sense of Sharon Sales Belton's passion, commitment, and intellect. And this is the year that I moved to Minnesota, and I was like, oh, moved to a place with Black Mirror, that's awesome. And I just remember just at the time thinking, I've made the right decision in moving here. This place is working on its issues. There's a reference to this earlier. 2 years after we elected Sharon Tills Mayor Belton, we sent a bunch of Black Minnesotans to the Million Man March. That was the story of the year. And Spokesman and Recorder powerfully captured the moment. Here's the way the story began. I love this lead. They said it couldn't be done. They said that Black men did not trust each other. They did not believe that more than 1 million Black men could gather without conflict. They were wrong. An estimated 1.5 million Black men lined a 23 blocks of the nation's capital that spanned from the base of the Lincoln Memorial to the steps of the Federal Building. This accomplishes two things. This particular one, it's not a newspaper page anymore. And this was referenced earlier by Dr. Chavis. All news outlets are now also digital, right? Have to do the old thing and the new thing. Have to be in multiple places, have to tell stories in a variety of new ways. And the Spokesman and Recorder are keeping up with the times, doing all kinds of work in digital spaces. President Obama's second inauguration was an occasion to capture the views of Minnesotans who traveled east to see his swearing in with their own eyes. And I've obviously spent a lot of time focusing on a lot of the national issues, but I want to take a moment to really underscore, and I think Jimmy's reference to his birthday party, that probably didn't make the cover, right? But it was in the paper. There was so much rich, detailed, frankly, love of this community throughout the pages of the Spokesman Recorder over the years. A ton of valuable information deep inside, beyond the covers, from issue to issue to issue. George Floyd's brutal murder at the hands of Derek Chauvin was one of the biggest stories of our lifetime. And Derek Chauvin's subsequent conviction was an important chapter in that story. The staff of the Spokesman Recorder told that story with great skill. Here's Mel Reeves's lead from that issue. Yeah, let's give it up for Mel. He wrote, a wild scene developed last Tuesday evening as history was made in the Twin Towns when Derek Chauvin was found guilty of murder, a conclusion that most reasonable and rational people had arrived at long before the trial. And not so long ago, we got this cover. When Governor Walz was tapped to be Vice President Kamala Harris's running mate, the Spokesman Recorder, as it's done for 90 years, brought it home and really helped our readers and its community understand the importance of this decision and what's at stake in this election ahead. I work in a nonpartisan environment, so I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, but I will tell you should definitely be voting on November 5th. And you should be, if you don't have one already, getting a subscription to the Spokesman Recorder so you can read the coverage of it shortly thereafter. I want to echo a point made earlier. It's a really tough business, whether you're in the mainstream press or in the Black press. And the reality is we're in an ecosystem. We need each other. We need to have different takes on life. We need to have different perspectives. We need to have multiple voices helping to shape our understanding of the world around us. In my 31 years in Minnesota, the Spokesman Recorder has helped me better understand, appreciate, and love this place. Tracey, my dear friend, I want to thank you for all the work you and the sacrifices your family have made over the decades. And Leticia, I'm with you for the next round, my friend. Let's get this thing going. Can we all please thank this family for their gift? thank you all for being here. And as I said, if you don't have a subscription, there are people here who can help you with that. Ange?
I've been associated with the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder for over 30 years. And one of the things I wanted to speak to today is about the impact that it has had on my life personally, and also how it's expanded to the community and beyond. My personal experience that has impacted me has been the first time I had the opportunity to come in and have a meeting with Ms. Tracey Williams-Dillard. And that meeting, that first meeting, I knew there was something special here because she expressed what her vision for the community and for this organization was 30 years ago. And I immediately was impacted by what she had said. And it gave me the energy and the realization that there is something more than just my corporate life and living that life. I wanted to do something in my life at that time that brought passion and made me feel like I was contributing to the community. As a result, in working over the years with Tracey, I found that her vision and her power and the impact has continued to build the legacy that her mother and her grandmother and her grandfather had already established. And Tracey works diligently to make sure that our message gets out there in every way, shape, or form. Through innovations, through technology, through her learning, through her willingness to bring a team together to make the MSR what it is today, she has succeeded in putting a mark not only locally, but regionally and nationally.
My name is Jimmy Stroud. My byline with the Spokesman Recorder reads James L. Stroud, Jr., writer slash photographer. It is a great honor just to be a part of this rich history with the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder newspaper. My first point of contact with the Spokesman Recorder was when I came back here in 1986. I was doing stand-up comedy, and I met Norma Jean, who wanted to interview me for, I think it was an upcoming show that I had. We talked a little while after the interview, became very good friends for the time that I've been here. And she gave me a gift that I still have, and she signed it on behalf of the newspaper. It was a book written about Cecil Newman's life. And I read it cover to cover. Blown away with the richness of the stories from before he started the paper until came to fruition, and then some of the other things that he did to really impact not only Minnesota and the African American community, but nationwide. I mean, with his friendship with Hubert Humphrey, a senator from Minnesota, who became vice president of the Johnson administration. There's pictures in that book and in our MSR archives, a picture of him standing next to two politicians, one Republican and one Democrat, who co-authored the bill for the 1964 Civil Rights Act. And Cecil Newman wordsmithed that document, as well as the 1968 Housing Act. Just that alone, I could go on. There's a number of stories and things that I don't have much time. So you just had to read the book, and also you keep subscribing and following the Spokesman Recorder.
Back in 2004, right, I was coming out of the Blake School, but I'm from North Minneapolis. And for those who are familiar with North Minneapolis, especially during that time, we weren't really doing the HBCU push like that. Matter of fact, at my school, as well as others, just said there wasn't any money. So I came to Tracey, and I applied for a scholarship. I got the Cecil E. Newman Award. That was the first $500. That I received to go to Morehouse College from my own community. The Minneapolis Spokesman Recorder has always been about education, has been about knowledge, and it's been about community. And it impacted my life because before that, I was under the belief that, you know, you got your best support from the outside looking in and not from the inside pushing out. And that showed me that there are people in the community, there are organizations in the community that believe in us, that highlight us in a positive type manner. You look at any of the other periodicals right now, and they'll show you that they want to talk about if there's a shooting. They want to talk about if there's a fight. They want to talk about how we disagree. But what the Minneapolis Spokesman-Recorder does for me, for my spirit, for this community and its spirit, is it gives knowledge. It highlights us at our best. It warns us at our worst. And it always gives us a strategy to move forward. Even when I moved on and I went to law school, Ohio Northern University, Claude W. Pettit College of Law. After my graduation, Tracy actually asked me to speak at the gala that they were having. And I will tell you, that was one of the most impactful moments of my life. Needless to say, I felt like a little superstar because everybody enjoyed it so much. I actually went over, I apologize, Tracy. I actually went over a little bit, but it seemed that the crowd enjoyed it. And even afterwards, I had people trying to get me to sign autographs. I was just somebody with a JD trying to make it out of Northside. So that's what this periodical has always been about for 90 plus years.
Cecil, what are you doing?
Leon, I'm trying to find a star.
Which star is that?
That one with the Midas touch. The one that makes my wish come true.
Relax, honey. I'm already here.
I'm just hoping that all this good work we're doing will still be happening long after I board that sleeping car bound for heaven.
Cecil, Spokesman Recorder is here to stay, and so are you, so stop.
Just promise me. Promise me that after I'm gone, you'll keep putting out the paper, spreading all this good news of our community that they need to hear and need to know.
Cecil, the chances of me running this whole shebang are slim to none, and Slim just left town.
Just, you will. And you'll make it bigger and better than ever. Mark my words.
I'll do you one better. I'll put those words into the next edition of the Spokesman Recorder.
Leona, you know what you are.
Do tell.
Unforgettable. That's what you are.
Unforgettable. Though near or far.
Like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more
unforgettable in every way.
And forevermore, that's how
you'll stay.
That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable
thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Well, Humphrey called again today.
About what?
Same as always. He
He and Johnson want me to pull up stakes and move to D.C.
And what did you tell him this time?
Same as always. My home's here. My work's here. My girl's here. And the people of this community need me here.
Here, here. But you can't blame them for trying, baby. You make a lasting impact. Never before has someone been more
and more every day.
Cecil Newman, I swear. Unforgettable.
That's what you are.
Unforgettable.
And forevermore.
That's how you'll stay.
That's how you'll stay.
That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Good night, everybody.
Unforgettable, absolutely, what we are here for this evening, trying to continue on with this legacy. And I'm Ms. Shannon Paul, and before, thank you, Angela. It's good to have friends in the room. I do agree with Angela's husband, though, because looking around this room, there are a lot of familiar faces. For those of you who don't know me, I am Ms. Shannon Paul. And before I was Ms. Shannon, who was on the radio and on the television, when I was just Shannon that moved here to Minneapolis with my mom and my two younger sisters in 1996 from Phoenix, Arizona, it was the Minnesota Spokesman-Recorder that made me know that I could be a part of this community. Because when you move here, you're just trying to find your feet and figure out, how do I fit into this situation? You know, there's a place that already had a history. There's a place that already had a legacy. How do I end up putting myself into this? And it was the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder that made my family and I know, wait a minute, this is where they came from, and this is how we can be a part of where it's going. So we appreciate all of you joining us this evening. And if you wonder why Ms. Shannon's up here, I am up here to remind you of a few things that you have heard so far this evening, like the fact that so many things have happened and actually been told in a way that centers Black people in Minnesota and the nation because of the news that has been published here with the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. And I know that eventually I ended up in media, but I really appreciated being able to be that Black woman in a room that when I saw TRACEY WILLIAMS-DILLARD walk into the room, I'm like, you know what? I am eventually going to belong here. So I always appreciated you being in the room, TRACEY. So thank you very much for everything you've done. And a humble brag, I am very honored that I've grown to the point that I'm one of the people in your cell phone that when you need somebody to come and support you, that I was able to answer this call. Because tonight, you have all heard about the rich history of the groundbreaking Black-owned business and newspaper and the real, sustained impact that it's had on our community here in Minnesota, year after year, decade after decade. And so now we would love for all of you to show your support as we move forward into the next 90 years. And you've talked about how important legacy is. And I want to remind you some of the things that you heard throughout tonight, because this is more critical than ever, because you really need to help us preserve local journalism. Because without papers like MSR, local stories might not be told. Remember that MSR creates an informed community, and that, as you heard, print advertising is drying up, and digital advertising means that much less revenue is being brought to the paper. Funding local papers like MSR has an economic impact by creating jobs,
for journalists, editors, photographers, and support staff, and it boosts our local economy. Now, what your support tonight does is it means that in the immediate future, MSR can expand their digital outreach to the broader Minnesota community. Also, supporting MSR means preserving our Black community's history and culture and ensures that future generations can look back and understand our heritage. Now, this evening, we are here to celebrate a successful, beautiful 90-year legacy. And we are also here to secure what will hopefully be an equally successful, beautiful, long future for our Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. Is that okay, everybody? Put your hands together. So, what we would love to do is that we are now going to give you a chance to support the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder in a couple of ways. If you look on your table right now, you'll see that there are some bid cards there. There's some numbers there. You can go ahead. There's some large. They look like 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper. I would love for one of you to just grab those and pass those around the table. There's one for each of you. It should have your name on it. Please don't take anybody else's name. I am not taking responsibility for that this evening. I'd love for you to take your own. And then what we're going to do over the next few minutes is that we are going to encourage you to go ahead and raise that card in support of the next 90-year legacy of MSR. So I'm going to go through a variety of numbers. I'm going to start a little high because I'm feeling a little spicy this evening. So we're going to start a little high, and then I'm just going to work through a number. And then if we get to one that you feel able to support MSR at, I would love for you to raise that card into the air. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to read out these numbers, and we're going to record them for you. And then what I need everybody else to do is we are just going to champion all of these names. So as you hear me read out these numbers, if you can just make some noise and send all of this gratitude and love out to the next 90-year legacy that we are starting tonight. Is that okay, everybody? So like I told you, I warned you, I'm going to start a little high, everybody. You know what we're trying to do. We're trying to make sure that we set ourselves up for success. So are there any friends, family, loved ones, leaders in the room right now that would be willing to raise that card right now and champion this legacy at the dollar amount of $5,000? Do I have any $5,000 leaders in the room right now? Do we have any $5,000 leaders? I'm going to ask you one more time. Do we have any $5,000 leaders, everybody? That's okay. Put your hands together and get some practice going. Come on now. All right, get those cards ready. Be ready to put those in the air. We're going to move on to our next dollar amount. Do we have anybody in the room that's ready to come in now at the $2,500 level? Do we have any $2,500 friends in the room right now? Anyone that's willing to come in as we move forward with this? Thank you very much. Number 221 at $2,500. Everybody put your hands together. Again, number 221. Do we have anyone else at that 25? Thank you. Number 177. Thank you so much, Dushan. Coming in at $2,500. Do we have any other $2,500 friends in the room right now? Thank you. Number 316. We see you. We appreciate you. Thank you very much. Coming in at $2,500. Anyone else at that level before we move on and we get some more people to raise those cards in the air? All right, here's what I need you to do. I need a little more energy than that. Everybody put your hands together for those $2,500 donations. As we continue on, you heard of all of the great works, and thank you very much again, Deshaun, for giving us that great anthology of what the MSR has done over the last 90 years. We move on to this next dollar amount. Do we have anyone ready right now to raise that card at the $1,000 level? Do I have any 1,000? Thank you. Number 348 at $1,000. We appreciate you. Number 352. Thank you for that $1,000. Thank you. Number 150. Thank you, my friend. Number 152. Thank you as well at $1,000. Number 473. Thank you for that $1,000. Number 250. Thank you as well, my friend. Number 452. Thank you for that $1,000. Number 4 four, one. Thank you. We appreciate you. Number 220. Thank you for that $1,000. Thank you in the back. I see you as well. Number 113 at $1,000. And coming to you over here, number 312. Thank you. We appreciate you. Everybody, you need to put more manifestation into this dollar amount. You act like you don't know how to put truth to power. We need to put more power behind this evening. As we move on to our next dollar amount, go ahead, get those arms nice and limber now as we move on to that next level. Who's willing to raise that card now as we move on to the $500 level? Do I have any $500? Thank you. Number 463 at $500. Number 388, thank you. We appreciate you. Number 612, thank you. I'm sorry, 610, thank you very much. Number 276, thank you. Number 119, thank you at 500. 486, thank you as well. 364, we appreciate you. 279, thank you. Number 292, thank you. Number 122, thank you. And number 572, thank you as well. I see you, my friend in the back. Number 593, thank you. I appreciate you. Waving it high with that energy. Number 405, thank you. Number 255, thank you as well. Number 237, thank you. And number 547, thank you. Number 251, also at $500. Did I miss anybody in this room? I want to make sure we get everybody. Come on, everybody, put your hands together. We have a few more levels. It's not every day you get to say, I'm going to be a part of history. I'm going to be the part of a legacy. I'm building something for another generation. So as we move on to this next level, who's ready now to raise that card at the level of $250? Do I have $250 in the room right now? Thank you, number 155. Number 365, thank you as well. Number 350, we appreciate you. In the back, number 466 and number 349, thank you for that $250. Number 131 and 124, thank you as well. 631 and 549, we appreciate you. Hello, my friend, number 345, and also my friend here, number 589 at $250. Number 172, we appreciate you. And under 190. Oh, got you over here. Number 541, also at $250. All right, now here's the part where things get fun. All right, I'm going to do one final level right now, but I do want to remind everybody before we move to this final level, many of you were already registered on ClickBid. So if I started too low, or I'm ending too high, we appreciate each and every one of you and would love for you to just go ahead. You can make that donation. You can also make a donation anytime you feel led by going to our website, spokesman-recorder.com. Tell all of your friends. If you get home and you go, hey, I know somebody in the neighborhood that I need to talk about the Spokesman Recorder to, please let them know that at any time they can go and hit that donate button. Is that right? That's right. So everyone, as we have our final level in the room right now, I'd love to get as much participation as possible. We appreciate all of you being here. We know that you're going to evangelize what the Spokesman Recorder is going to continue to do as we move forward. So now, is there anyone ready to raise that card at our final level this evening at the $100 level? Thank you. Number 397 starting us. Number 450, thank you. Number 455, we appreciate you. Number 454. Thank you. Number 581, thank you. Number 613, thank you. Y'all better start clapping now. It's going to be a long time. Number 448, we appreciate you. Numbers 247 and 170, 169 and 574, 173 and 254. 174 and 458, thank you. 175 and 176, thank you. 163 and 378, 480 and 281, thank you. 160 and 148, 149 and 293, 560 and 354, 355 and 361, 497 and 363, thank you. 358 and 545, thank you. 283 and 284, thank you very much. Coming over here, friends. 439 and 229, thank you. 232 and 427, we appreciate you, my friend, thank you. 157 and 536, 225 and 125, 201 and 211, we're almost there, everybody, come on now. 215 and 614, everybody, put your hands together. Thank you all so much for all of the support that you've shown in the room tonight. Thank you for showing up for this community and for this amazing family that's going to continue to do great work as they move into the future. Thank you, everybody. Angela, the stage is yours. Thank you very much.
And thank you so much, Ms. Shannon. It's always wonderful to be in the room with you. And thank you to everyone who generously donated tonight to the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. All right, so for a final few comments before the night concludes, I want to invite up to the stage a message from the CEO and publisher of the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder in her gorgeous red gown again. Let us hear from Tracey Williams-Dillard.
Thank you, Angela. Thank you so much. You've done a wonderful job. You make me proud, so thank you. I know that I want to make this brief. I said there was a lot of things about this night that I wanted to happen, and to this moment, everything that I wanted to happen has happened. So I want to thank all of you. I want to just take a brief moment to really recognize and honor my uncle. My uncle Jack is the last living soldier of the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder next to me. I love you, Uncle Jack. He was one of the people that he took the Spokesman Recorder from standing in front of an old grid sheet, pasting up the paper every night, till he brought the computers in, the old computers that we used to have. He brought them in, and he made it so that we now had a way we could get out of there before midnight. So that was a great thing. And then he was a busybody. He was always trying to think of different things and being innovative. So he came up with this idea of creating this thing called the Minnesota Black Pages. And, go ahead, yes, yes. And he was a forward thinker, so he thought about ideas that, you know, we're promoting the black businesses that we do today. We just do it within the pages of the MSR. We don't have a separate book. So he led the path for me to be able to follow on that. So I just want to give tribute and homage to my Uncle Jack for being there to support the paper when he was there, and I love you and I thank you. And I, you know, there was, when my grandmother handed the paper over to me, it was in a state of struggle. So tonight with your contributions, I just want to tell you kind of what it means to me. There were days when the paper was struggling and my staff stayed and I told them that I was struggling and I showed them the books and I wasn't taking a paycheck home. But I told them as long as I could make sure that they were taking one, that I would make sure they did. It got to a point where they weren't taking a paycheck home. But none of them walked out on me. But the struggle wasn't gone just because they were there to make sure a paper didn't get missed every week. The struggle was still there. My husband at the time, I lost him to COVID in 2019. He started working another job. He said, if this paper means that much to you, I'm going to help you keep it going. So he went out and he took another job so that I could make payroll, so that we could continue to put the news and information out to this community to serve the way that my grandfather intended for this paper to do. So he worked hard and tirelessly until he got COVID, of course, but before he passed, he was there to see the paper start to make an uptick. So Dr. Chavis talked about how we gotta have advertising, and I wanna thank my colleagues here that have traveled from different cities and states, to be here tonight with us to celebrate. But he talked about the need for advertising, and that's one of the things that pulled us out of the rut we were in, was we got a lot of money from the census at the time coming through NMPA, thank you NMPA. And then there was also the unfortunate thing was COVID, and they had to figure out a way to reach the black community. And the only way they could reach it in a really strong, powerful way was to use the black press. So they had to end up dumping a lot of money, thank you, into the black press in order for it to get the message out to the community about how we needed to wear a mask and wash our face and watch out for this terrible pandemic that was out there that was gobbling a lot of our lives up. So they gave us the advertising dollars in order for us to be able to do that. So that got us through another hump. So we slowly are coming out of this hump and we're starting to kind of be the little engine that could. But at the same time, now we got this whole thing with the internet, right? So now they're stopping doing a lot of print advertising and they're putting a lot more money into the digital. But the digital doesn't pay like the internet, like print did, because there's so much digital out there. So understanding your contributions tonight was important for me to get up here and thank you for them, because they mean a lot to continue to help us to grow. So thank you for that. And I just want to say that they mentioned earlier in a couple of speeches that this was like a family reunion. Well, it is, because it's just like, to me, a family reunion, because one of the things personally, I feel like a lot of the people that are in this room, they came out to support the MSR, but as I walked through this room tonight, I felt the love for Tracey Williams Dillard. When my friends traveled across the country, when my family came and sat here tonight, when all of my friends came, when my grandkids came, that means a lot, because this is a struggle that I have lived with to make sure that we don't miss a paper. No matter how hard it is, I keep doing it. I wake up every morning committed to you guys in the community that we're gonna give you the news, we're gonna give you the information, and then we're gonna give you the facts the way that nobody else will. And when I know that my efforts and my staff done a phenomenal job tonight making sure that this room looks as beautiful as it does, I wanna thank my staff for being here. It's just unbelievable. I just have all this help and all this support, and I feel all that love tonight, and it was very important for me to get up tonight and just thank each one of you. I want to thank Angela. I want to thank Deshaun, my dear friend. I want to thank Jimmy for flying in here and spending time with me tonight. I want to thank this performance. Wasn't it phenomenal? Oh, my goodness. They're talking about my grandmother and my grandfather and how they're unforgettable. Oh, that song was so pretty. And I just want to thank all of you that have come out tonight and spent your night with me. And I know it's becoming a long evening, so I'm not going to talk anymore. But it was important for me to personally get back up and just thank all of you for coming out and thank you for your support. And I want to ask you to continue to support the MSR, and we'll continue to support you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tracy, and congratulations. That is a wrap, everybody. A big thank you once again for your incredible generosity this evening, which will help ensure that the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder continues to be such an important part of our community in the years to come. You are welcome to stay, hang out, continue to enjoy each other's company, take some pictures. The pavilion and the bar will remain open for a bit more tonight. Remember to pick up your silent auction items. The checkout area is outside of the Great Northern Ballroom where the auction was held. And if you haven't already done so, if you want an item or made a donation, please, please enter your credit card information into ClickBid, and this will expedite your checkout. And also, an important announcement, the centerpieces at the table. If you like the centerpieces, so you like flowers, go ahead and look for under the centerpiece card under number one chair. Okay, so if you are the winner of the centerpiece, if you look under the table, under your chair, if you find something like this under your chair, you won the centerpiece. So the centerpieces get to go home. So if you have this card under your chair that says you're a winner, please check. Go ahead and take the centerpiece home. Thank you again for being here for the 90th anniversary celebration for the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder to pay tribute to the man who had the vision to inspire a community and to impact the world. And please, give me your attention here at the stage, because his legacy will carry on and his memory will never be far from our minds as we think of Cecil E. Newman, because he is, in a word,
unforgettable.
In every way.
In every way.
And forevermore.
And forever.
That's how you'll stay.
That's how you'll stay. That's why,
darling, it's incredible
that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Sincere good night.
Good night, everybody.
Are you Uncle Jack? He's over there.